And it just signified to me that actually human beings are social beings. They have to socialize and everything. I just think that's how we're actually built. And
I couldn't say more, man.
I can attest that that lockdown, I believe that it might have created some psychological things on some people. I can
It
bet
might
that,
have.
you know.
It might have.
And so there is always a need for people to come together. There's always a need for people to, you know, to socialize and everything. And I think that's where we need people like you, people who always come up with concepts that bring people together and everything like that. Tell us about Farm Source.
Lita, thank you. Thank you very much. You know, I think I want to be on unscripted more. You know, I feel like we are vibrating on the same wave, Lita.
Vibrations,
You know, this
the combos
questions
are
of yours,
communicating.
hey Lita, this questions of yours are giving me something they call intellectual orgasm.
It. Okay. This is it.
Indeed, you are here,
Indeed,
inside.
we
Look
are
at
packed
us.
inside. Too
Look
much
at
sauce.
God.
Too much sauce. Oh, look at God.
Bona
Look at Mudimu.
Mudimu. How
Yeah,
are you,
this
Lynn?
is. I'm great, and how are you?
Oh, no, I'm good, leader. Thank you for having me, man. Finally, I get to make it to the ranks, you know.
This is Conference Scripted. You know, this is a platform where we talk our minds, our ideas, and our thoughts, and where we talk and have conversations of intergenerational significance. And today on Conference Scripted, we have a leader, the founder. You know, I'd like to term you as the founder actually, because I realize that actually you have been very vital, you know,
Indeed,
in
indeed.
founding a lot of concepts and a lot of organizations, you know, founder of Farm Source Market, you know, market manager there, managing
Yes,
the Farm
indeed.
Source Market, the president at Club Readership, the
Hey,
deputy
is that you,
chairman.
leader? Indeed,
The deputy chairman and I think executive director of the Faculty of Best Advisory and Educator
indeed.
as well. You know,
Definitely.
welcome, Sibusiso
Thank you very much for having me,
Gama.
leader. It's a pleasure to be here. And you say it well when you say we need to talk about issues of intergenerational significance, because that for me speaks to intergenerational wealth, which I think maybe as an introduction, that's why maybe I even come across to you as somewhat a founder, because I'm just trying to make sure that, you know, the future is secured.
And I think we need to
Yes.
start there, you know, especially as black people, to start talking about intergenerational wealth. Because, you know, if you look
Definitely.
into the concept itself, you know, and you look at other races, and you know, of course, there is issues of privilege and all of those kind of things. But I think since we're at the bottom of the food chain, we are the ones who actually must spearhead this conversation of intergenerational wealth. Do you feel like we're
Definitely.
doing that?
To some extent, leader, to some extent, you know, we should not cast all the stones, because I think we come a long way. We should also recognize the good that we have done, even if we fall short along the way because of maybe the authorities that we trust or just the situation we find ourselves in. But I can say, in short, we are doing that because if we have the likes of you on Unscripted giving us the chance to even talk about this, because I think airtime is very important. Airtime, you know, if somebody sits there and listens to this one day when I'm 20 years dead, we have documented history, my leader. Someone will say there was once upon a time a leader of Ghana who was known as the founder who said for him intergenerational wealth means 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And documentation is one of the ways we can work on our intergenerational wealth, because we're not only talking about the riches. The riches come in many forms, in many flames and flavors, my leader, you know. It comes in spaces like this where we get to talk our mind, we get to, you know, balance each other on the ideologies, in spaces where we create a network for one another, whereby if you start a business, even if it's so difficult for you, already have, that network of people who can say, Asambe Lord.
Yeah,
let's go. You know, so it means a lot, you know. So in short, I can say we are doing exactly that, my leader. But like one of the leaders would say, we have not arrived. The best pages of our lives are yet to be written, and we remain in the journey.
Indeed, indeed.
And then how about you, leader? Do you think we are doing well in that instance?
Yeah, I think you know, there must be a start, you know. And the thing that myself I always say about everything, you know, is like, firstly, there must be some conscientizement. There must be some education as well. So when coming to concepts of intergenerational wealth, especially as Black people, I think number one, we need to delve into financial literacy. You know, we need to delve into leadership. You know, so there is a lot of, I think, concepts that we need to empower ourselves with first before then we embark. Because I used to have a classmate who was white, and yes. I remember him telling me that him and his girlfriend have actually opened an investment account for their child who's not yet born. And he was like, it was like they contribute 500 rand each to the account, so that's 1,000 per month times 12, that is 12,000, multiply that by 18 and the interest as well. Actually multiply that by 21, because that's where most of them, that's where the 21st birthday party comes from. And that's where they do that. So when we see these people in our campuses driving our dream cars, decisions were made, you know? And I thought about it blew my mind. I was like, it's something so simple. I mean, 500 is not that much. And it is people,
very achievable,
you know, and everything like that. So I was like, that child, if this investment account goes for 18 years, probably when the child goes to school, they already have an apartment, they have a car, they sorted. These things of us going for bazaaries, having long queues there by NSFAS and everything like that, it has to stop, you know. We need to start thinking about this kind of thing. So for me, I think it's the mindset thing first. Let's start to deal with the mindset, because I mean, you have people who would blow 500 in a party, which can be invested, you know, for years, and then which can actually, you know, have some very nice financial rewards in the end. So let's start with the conscious first. Let's start conscientizing the mind. Let's start with the mindset and everything like that. So even concepts such as farm source, they need to, we need to have a vision, and it has to be sustainable. One day farm source must be actually, even if it's a mall, so be it, whereby this is a mall about, you know, whatever form is going to take.
Down so I four. Feel,
yeah, I Down feel like four. This is, that's where we actually need to start. In fact, talking about farm source, since we're already down into it, you know, in the lockdown, not this one, I feel like this one is not really the lockdown. This one, there is movement. Remember that lockdown, the heavy one, the military one?
The hard-hitting lockdown.
The hard-hitting lockdown. Yeah. And I remember during that time, man, I was lonely. Men are confessing.
The young man was lonely there, Linda.
The young man was lonely. No, because, you know, I'm someone who I love meeting people, I love conversing, I love, you know, those kind of things. And for the first time, I found myself spending the entire week in my dorm room. And I was like, really? And it just signified to me that actually human beings are social beings. They have to socialize and everything. I just think that's how we're actually built. And I can attest that lockdown, I believe that it might have created some psychological things on some people. I can bet that.
It might
have. You know.
It might have.
And so there is always a need for people to come together. There's always a need for people to, you know, to socialize and everything. And I think that's where we need people like you, people who always come up with concepts that bring people together and everything like that. Tell us about Farm Source.
Linda, thank you. Thank you very much. You know, I think I want to be on Unscripted more. You know, I feel like we are vibrating on the same wave.
The vibrations, you know, the combos are communicating.
Hey, leader, these questions of yours are giving me something they call intellectual orgasm.
Ah! That's it.
So thank you for that question, my leader. You know, to just make maybe an example, if you check, people always say that in tragedy there's opportunity. So maybe not that much being opportunistic, but we realize that lockdown has had an impact on people, and that impact being both economic and social. Social in the sense that everyone is locked in their homes, and now it means they can't go out there and mingle with people. And being social beings, as you have just mentioned, it means that now you start having all these issues of mental illness, you start having more violence because people are just sitting at home and, you know, they're just in the same room. And then there's a whole lot of things that can come out of that. And economic in the sense that then people lose their jobs because company were cutting down cost, cutting down, retrenching employees. So we said, and we said, you know what, as much as it is a problem, but this is also an opportunity for us to say, after this lockdown, even though we won't go back to the normal, but let's create a space where people can go and socialize again. While socializing, let's also create an opportunity for them to explore entrepreneurial opportunities where we can form a network. For us, it's the network. To say, yes, you are having a good time, good food, you're selling good art, good clothes, and you're listening to good music, but most importantly, let us make that wealth. That wealth being the vendors that we have there, them sharing business with each other, or them getting that opportunity to come and showcase the products that they have. The wealth being that person who is an upcoming artist who needs that space, that audience to come and showcase their talent. You know, the mood, leader, you know. It's something, I think it's something bigger than me, bigger than you, bigger than all of us. But of course, you are right when you say we need people like us to make it a success to start with and make it normal for young black people to see that you can do it. You know, you don't have to be a millionaire. You can do it. You can just do it, you know.
Sure. No, that's very dope. And I think my understanding of, like, you know, especially crashes, you know, for me, crashes are very much interesting. Like, I talk about economical crashes in this case, your recessions, your depressions, and everything like that. In fact, when I delve into the readings and all of those kind of things, I realize actually that the most powerful things that we have today, be it companies and everything like that, most of them were born during depressions, where there are crashes, like, you know, the economy is crashing, everyone is like, I think that's actually a very good opportunity to start something, don't you think?
You are right, Lida. I think so. And maybe if you can grant me the opportunity to say, I know so. Because that's exactly what we've done. And maybe if I can extend a bit on that, it's not going to be easy because already we are starting in a tough time, and or during a tough time, you need to understand that you need to rise to the occasion like no any other time. And you have yourself to depend on. And then other people who are depending on either you or the idea. If you can't do it, but the idea just can't die. It needs to be so big that it just can't die, you know.
So
I can agree with you, my leader. And I can say, when we started, it started off a bit,
you know,
because people don't know who you are, what are you trying to do?
Yeah.
Like this one, we want to go on lockdown. He wants us to go out there. And then it's that conscientizing of the mind that you were talking about. So you do it. You hit the ground running and you explain while running. Because if you think you're going to tell people what it is first for it to work, it's definitely most probably not going to work. So then people start understanding the idea, even though it's during difficult times.
Yeah.
But because of those difficult times, if what you are doing speaks to that difficult times and it's a solution of some sort, people are going to be with you, man. I'm telling you.
Yeah.
They're seeing that with some sort.
Yeah. Look, I think business and even entrepreneurship, even leadership, you know, I think it's about problem solving. you know, and it's in a time of a crisis where the real entrepreneurs rise, where the real leaders rise, because now
volume leader.
because a crisis just means that there are many problems to solve. And I think if you're a creative thinker, I think if you're someone who is someone who's always with ideas and everything, to be in a crisis is actually it's like being a kid being in a lollipop, because that's when you need to solve. That's when you need to rise to the occasion and everything like that.
Right.
So I think that the timing of FarmSource, I think, is very much perfect. But just to conceptualize FarmSource, from my understanding, and I was in your website yesterday, man, that thing blew my mind. I don't want to lie. Like, I was just like, what? Because here you have, okay, the FarmSource market. Most markets, in most cases, it's just about, you know, selling and buying. That's what a lot of markets are. And I think that's also the understanding of markets from an economic perspective, buy and sell. Yes. But I was viewing at this market, I'm like, wait, here there is fun. There is socialization. Yes. There is entertainment.
Definitely.
There is food.
Definitely.
There is clothing. You know, there is the vibe, you know, it's the vibes, as they say.
Too much sauce.
And I was just like, this is very dope, you know, because actually what you guys are creating, and I think I commend you guys for this, is that you're creating a market ecosystem, you know, an integration of different markets into one market. And I think for me, that's huge. So let's get into the conceptualization. What happened? You were sitting and then the idea just flew in your mind. We were in a conversation with Soren. So, because I know you co-founded this with Minanka Koza, take me through that moment whereby like this thing just like snapped. What was happening? Were you reading something and you'd be like, I think this is it. Let's go for this and everything, because I think it's dope, man.
Yeah, no, thank you very much for that, leader. I hope other people find it dope as well.
Yeah.
If not dope, at least functional in one way or another.
Sure.
So the conceptualization, leader, is, I think, okay, so I like markets. I would go to markets and all the time I'm trying to learn, you know?
Mm.
And I saw, and because of going there all the time, then I tried on my side to find a style there, to become a vendor, which was very difficult, right? And because Eminently is part of Faculty of Guest Advisory and we are leaders together there, and then the conversation just integrated, and I found out that she's trying to do the same thing. Then I was like, no, leader, but if you're experiencing the same problem as me, that was even before lockdown, maybe let's try to do something together. But it was just, you know, a lazy conversation, you know?
Yeah.
Until it was necessitated by COVID-19, then we saw that people need it now more than ever. And now there's a need for us not to just want to fit into a frame, but to create the picture, you know?
Sure.
And we said, the point of departure is us going to back to those markets when they open with a different eye, not an eye of entertainment, not an eye of just being there. We look what they are doing, we talk to the right people, we poach vendors if we have to, because you have to be adamant, my dear. There's no romanticizing of issues if you want to succeed in business.
Sure.
And we said, let's just do it. And then we started saying, wherever you are driving, wherever you are, look at a spot where you think this thing can work, and look at a spot where there's less activity happening so that we can bring that activity. And then we identified that space, that side, to say there's a garage, there's a car wash, there's traffic. Eventually this thing is gonna work. We approached the owners there, we had some leadership conversations.
Sure.
And it was a lengthy conversation. We had about 8 meetings before it could start. Back and forth, back and forth. Come explain this. Okay, we understand. They go, they come back. No, we don't understand this. Tell us this, you know. And maybe if I can include that, part of what then started motivating us was that, you know what, we've seen all the markets and we are not trying to reproduce what they are doing.
Sure.
We can learn from them. We want to produce something that is coherent. Coherent in the sense that it is going to bring people across different spheres, bring them together. Those people are not only going to be doing business with each other on the market. even beyond the market. If there's someone who's selling cocktails and there's someone who's selling fruits, that person who's selling fruits must supply the person who's selling cocktails, even beyond the day of the market. Now we're creating a value chain. And we say, out of that value chain, and then we start expanding. We start moving from where we are at the port at the moment. We start moving to social movement. We start moving to all the areas where people are, and there's no such a vibe. But most importantly, there is a need for business and a need to come and showcase. Because we've seen that, you know, for the longest time, the mind has been captured. We are being called to seminars. We have to pay. And you listen to someone telling you, and there's nothing wrong with that. But I think it's a passive way of trying to eradicate these problems that we have. So we didn't go study to make markets, but here we are. We are learning as we go. After every market, we get something new that you, is that how you do that? And how do you solidify the value chain? What is your talent retention? Because if this vendor is good and you're not offering value, they are going to go. So what is your long-term goal? And we start having those conversations to say, vendors don't have a tunnel vision. We are going far. We are going to be multidisciplinary. We are going to be in different locations, and we want you to be part of the journey. And if you understand our value and our vision, and then I think it's worth staying. We have given you an opportunity when other markets were shutting you down. You opened the door. The least you can do is to maintain us so that we can open another door for someone else. So remain part of the journey, you know? So my leader, I think, you know, I just become too much when I'm thinking about this, leader. I'm even thinking faster than I'm talking. But I think the long and short of it, my leader, is that we want to create a value chain. And in that value chain, as a vendor, you can't just be a vendor. You need to be running a sustainable business, in a sense that the money you will be paying probably at FarmSource when we start charging stars, we take a portion of that money, we invest it. At some point, we have a business shower of some sort to say, here's a vendor who's doing so well. We're focusing on them this time. Let's pamper them. We just pamper them with all the things they need to say, you are a vendor, but we want, when you go to your location, to find that idea you are doing here at FarmSource standing. If we remove FarmSource, you are standing on your own, and you just remain part of it because you understand the bigger vision.
Yeah. Talk about power, man. Talk about power, powerful ideas. I'm actually just having an intellectual orgasm.
You know? Indeed. Do my sauce with the flowing all around.
That's what I'm saying, that when I like just actually thought about it, and when I looked into it, I was even saying to myself that, do these leaders understand what they've just created? You know? Because sometimes as a creator, you're just driven by creating, you know, but sometimes you have passion and everything. But I was just looking at it, I was like, you know, do these people understand the monster and the disruptor that they've created? Because here's the thing. And I like that you have touched on it, right?
Yeah.
The value chain, right? And I think is a concept that I think as leaders and even as entrepreneurs, we need to understand. Because if you do not own a value chain, and if you don't create a value chain, then you don't have power in the market. You don't have a say actually in the market. You get what I'm saying? So if you have a vendor in FarmSource who is a farmer, right? And you have another vendor who sells vegetables, right? And you have another vendor who actually maybe makes smoothies, just to give an example. That's a value chain.
That's a value chain, my leader. That's the absolute definition of it.
Yeah, and it needs to be connected right away, because if you don't actually have a very good value chain, it hurts the business, number one, but it also hurts the consumer even more. Because now if I'm a someone who does smoothies, but I'm not connected to someone who sells vegetables, and I'm not connected to someone who is a farmer, then wherever I'm gonna go, the price that I'm gonna be charged, I don't have a say on it. And then now, because I'm charged a very high price, then obviously I want to make profit as well. So now I'm gonna also go into inflate the price. So the consumer definitely. At the end and it is everything like that. So
definitely
if you just get that part right of the value chain and everything like that. But there is something powerful about value chains in that's economy. That's how you create an economy.
Yeah. Yeah.
I once read an article that I think it was very powerful in the sense that if you look into, especially in South Africa right now, you do have our brothers from other countries coming to our country, you know, for greener pastures, of course. But look at how they disrupted the market. They just threw value chains. I mean, look at the spaza shop industry right now, you know. Look into the salons right now. You get what I'm saying? And these guys, I think they understand the concept of value chain very well, in a sense that whenever they come here, when they establish each other, it's all about, you know, making the money secret around themselves. So I'm a salon owner. You are the one who coming up with the braids. You do the braids and everything like that amongst themselves. And I think it's a concept that we need to really delve much into, because I think it's very powerful. So that's why we need farm source, you know, to lead us into this and everything like that. Look, you know, you have been on the ground with farm source. I think you have had a couple of sessions so far. Yes, and sir. You know, I'm an entrepreneur, and one of the things that I think as entrepreneurs struggle with is the market. So you find that you're an entrepreneur, you have a very dope idea, you execute it, maybe you even have the product, and you even have a target market. But sometimes you find that with the target market, you do not have accessibility. Or you find that actually, you can't actually find yourself in the market, because the product has to be in the market. The product has to be right in the middle of the traffic.
Definitely.
Now, look at Farm Source. Look at Farm Source. That's the traffic.
You're
packed inside. You're packed inside. So what are those things that you've observed? You know, you cited earlier about, you know, seeing entrepreneurs connecting, networking and everything like that. But what has been the experience of the entrepreneurs on the ground? What has been your observation that you're just like, whoa, what is this?
I think that's what I'm saying. If someone is not careful enough, they might think we've scripted this. Your questions are just, you know, when the questions allow you to go there, you go.
Yeah.
You know, because I feel like you have the, as the interviewer, or in, you have the power to make or break the conversation. And then you've been making it. We shine in makeup.
Mascara.
Ay. See, I can't see a drawer.
Sure.
Okay,
sure.
That's a beautiful question, Malida. I think the sad reality is that, if I can show you the spreadsheet, I think we're sitting at 146 applications from the vendors. And in that, for me, it's like, yo, okay, so this thing is actually bigger than what I thought, number one. Number two, people are having it hard, right? And you can see people who are applying there, that it's people who mean business. They call you almost every week to a chance. Has somebody withdrawn? What number am I on the list? And answering those questions is very, very sad, my dear, because you know, you constantly have to say no, the vendor, because if you've approved the vendor, there's no way you can say, maybe instantly or momentarily, there's no way you can say now you're gonna take more, because when you're working with entrepreneurs, you need to provide value for them, and the value is monitoring who's there, so that there's variety of products, but then there's no duplicates, so that you give somebody a chance at the market. And that then means it becomes limited in the number that you can post there. And at the moment, we are at full capacity, you know. But we keep those applications at hand, because, like I said, the idea is to expand, but also to form a network. To say, even if you are not part of it instantly or literally at the market where we are, but we want you to be part of the value chain to say, what are you doing? We have the conversation beyond the day of farm source. What are you doing? We have this together, and we are just the mediator so that, you know, there's that cohesion. And I think my leader, you know, to see, this is very emotional for me.
Yeah.
Immediately after the market, for someone to come and say, thank you. It's not yet that day, but I can see where you guys are going.
No, those are there for a pass. They are passing
you know,
by.
You know, somebody just says, I can see where you guys are going, and I'm glad to be part of the journey. Thank you for creating this space. And I mean, my leader, that's why then you see even maybe people from the media opening their doors and saying, guys, you know what you're just doing is just big. Come and talk about it. Come and tell us about the idea. Because you see, leader, in business, if you stop making it about you, because if it's about you, you're going to be the death of the business, most probably. You know? Make it about the people, and I quote, if Bonang Matheba was here, she would say, give the people what they want.
Just
give the people.
Yeah, you know? true.
And allow yourself to be led.
Yeah,
allow yourself
true,
to be led.
True.
Indeed.
True. Man, like I'm having a mind block, like, like this is, yo, man. Yeah,
it's beautiful.
It's beautiful. But I think another thing that, you know, I'm just thinking about, as in when you talk about the applications and how many entrepreneurs are there, and that's why what keeps on coming to my mind is like, but do the leaders understand the disruptor that this is? Because